Welcome back to the latest TV news. Coming up, we'll have all the important weather where we are. But first, we were speaking there to Rod Dean from the Shoreham Airshow before. Now I'm joined by the events commentator, Terence Henderson, and welcome to you. And I seem to remember you when I've been going to the airshow for many years now, and you were like a guest quite a few times to just suddenly talk about Concorde, because you were actually a Concorde pilot.
That's correct. I flew Concorde for 10 years. Finally retired from Concorde in 1998. That's 5 years before it went out of service. But in the meantime, I went and flew for other airlines for another 11 years.
Surely after the Concorde, you would want to fly anything else, would you?
It's a very good question. Not so. To fly Concorde, you had to be an enthusiast. Nobody who flew that aeroplane was not already an enthusiast, because it was difficult. There were at times extraordinarily challenging decisions that had to be made on it, and only those people that enjoyed flying would even contemplate going onto it. And so when I retired, all I wanted to do was fly aeroplanes, so it didn't really matter which one. I just was happy to fly them.
I'm sure. But when you went to sort of supersonic speed, what's the experience like doing that?
Very little, actually.
Really?
It is a remarkable machine. I used to demonstrate it to the annoyance of the co-pilots, but you take the automatic pilot out, trim the aeroplane just below the speed of sound.
Is that when the nose goes, yeah, goes down?
Well, you trim the aeroplane, we're just below the speed of sound, and you trim the aeroplane for going through the sound barrier, put the extra power on, apply the reheats again, apply the afterburners, and then you would literally take your hands off the controls and the aeroplane would glide through the speed of sound without a twitch. Yeah. And of course, for those of us who were brought up watching programs, films like Sound Barrier, where there was buffeting and tremendous amount of turbulence associated with going transonic through the sound barrier, this was almost unbelievable. But really, it was the most beautifully designed aeroplane.
So your skin didn't leave your face, and you didn't suddenly yeah, it didn't suddenly go back.
We deliberately used to leave the cockpit door open so that passengers could see that we were in fact dressed normally in shirt sleeves, like they were, because there was always a slight concern that the passengers might think that we're sitting there with ejector seats with special equipment on, so that we could always leave the aeroplane if anything went wrong, which was quite the reverse, of course.
Yeah. Are you sort of shocked the way that aircraft have evolved over the years?
Not shocked. Always interested. Of course, the main reason for being in an airline is to stay in business, and to stay in business, you've got to make money. And it is vitally important that all your aeroplanes, in fact, generate some money for the airline. Otherwise, you no longer cease to exist.
Yeah.
And therefore, it's not surprising to see the way the airliners have gone, where cost reductions and maximum income are what's required.
I think I told you before, my son flies the A380, which is a rather large aircraft, but he doesn't feel like he's flying it, because all he is he's got a computer board in front of him, and that's it.
Very true. I did fly some of the later marks of aeroplanes, not as advanced as the A380. I flew the little tiny Airbus, in fact, for a short while. Interesting aeroplane. A lot of the technology derived from Concorde, in fact, an awful lot of the technology, particularly the fly-by-wire. I did find flying the little Airbus, it didn't have quite the same appeal as the Concorde. There wasn't quite the same feel through the controls, and that's something which, the sort of thing I try to explain at the air show is to the people in our crowd, our guests there, I try to explain to them what it's like to fly an aeroplane, and of course a lot of it is feel. Rod's just been describing flying some of the massive, beautiful fighters of the 1950s and 1960s, and also describing the Spitfire, for instance. I had a co-pilot colleague who actually flew Concorde to New York with me one day. We arrived in New York together, and he'd been flying the aeroplane for me over from London. And he was grinning away like a Cheshire cat. And I said, "Why are you looking so pleased?" And he said, "You won't believe it, but I flew a Spitfire this morning." And he remains the only person who's ever flown the two aircraft on the same day. But my first question to him was not congratulations, but what's it like to fly? He said, "Just like Concorde."
Unbelievable. So, at the air show, one of the great things about you is, because of the experience you have, you can actually put across exactly what's going on in the air.
I try to. I do try to. And spectators seem to be generally, they generally welcome those remarks. So it's not purely a technical explanation of what's going on, but I try to give them some quality, some idea of the qualitative side of flying, what it really feels like, what the pilot's doing at this moment, probably doing at this moment.
How many years have you been doing this now?
At the air show, approximately 10 years. As you rightly said, I used to do part of the commentary, and then I moved in. Peter Eager, my predecessor, found the task of running the air show and also doing the commentary too great a task, and so he handed over the commentary to me. I learned a lot from him. I learned nearly everything from him, in fact, and I owe him a great debt.
Yeah,
great
yeah.
man.
And you enjoy those days there?
Oh, it's a stunning day. I mean, my wife hates it because it takes me about a week to wind down. It takes about a week to wind up as
how
well.
How long does it take you to get organised for it?
You are subconsciously working on it, as Rod said, quite early on in the year. I'm looking at the programme, I'm thinking about what we ought to do and say.
So what are the star attractions this year?
Oh, the star attractions this year, well, the major for me, the star attraction is the Vulcan. The Vulcan is coming for its very last year.
That's on the Sunday, isn't it?
It's on the Sunday, mm-hmm. That's correct. It will be a once and a lifetime chance to see it for the very last time. Another wonderful event this year will be the Sea Vixen, which is stunning in its own right. I had many friends who flew Sea Vixens when I was a youngster. Mm-hmm. But I'm also looking forward to seeing aircraft like the Junkers 52. We're going to get one of the old tri-motors, the three-engine tri-motors. I was actually asked to fly one back from Kazakhstan once to England. It didn't happen, but I'm looking forward to seeing the thing in the air.
Do you still get to behind the controls?
Yes, I fly pretty much every week. Mm-hmm. I own a few gliders, mostly vintage gliders, and I have a chipmunk light aircraft, a sort of mini warbird, which I fly, and I also fly a glider tug.
I look forward to seeing you on the 22nd, 23rd of August.
We look forward to
it. Thank you so much, Steve, for being with us today.
My pleasure.
Good luck to you. Thank you very much indeed.